Killer Kitchen will return next week right here on the Angry 80s Guy YouTube channel. For now, I hope you'll be happy with this. Welcome to a very small piece of Killer Kitchen. This is going to be a very simple episode tonight, and you'll notice I do not have my normal MGD in my hand or any other alcoholic drink. Quite honestly, just couldn't afford it this week, which is kind of why you're getting a short episode. Okay. This one, just simple, easy Kraft macaroni and cheese. Now what I'm gonna do, dump an entire stick of butter in there like that. And because this is Killer Kitchen, where nothing is ever as it seems, we're gonna add some red food coloring so that we can make this macaroni and cheese look like bloody intestines. Now you're adding yellow cheese, so you're gonna need a little extra red. That's why you saw me just douse it in there. Now what we're gonna do, stir this up. For our show tonight, I wanna bring you my favorite, I'm not sure what you call it. It's my favorite story by Edgar Allan Poe, The Telltale Heart. This episode, we're showing you a cartoon that was made in 1957. And don't get it wrong, just because it's so old, this one will definitely hold you and grip you to the very end. I just gotta say one thing, as a personal slice of philosophy, I feel that yes, this man was totally insane. At least, when it came down to it, his insanity came to a grinding halt at the very end in a very surprising way. So without any further ado, let's just roll him. Oh, and tonight, we're gonna take these cheap-ass piece of shit fucking wannabe soy burgers, and I'm gonna show you how to doctor them up to make them actually taste good. So, I'll see you guys in a few.
I'm nervous. Very, very dreadfully nervous. But why will you say that I'm mad? See how calmly, how precisely I can tell the story to you. Listen. It starts with the old man. An old man in an old house. A good man, I suppose. He had never harmed me. I didn't want his gold, if gold there was. Then what was it? I think it was his eye. Yes, that eye, the eye. That. His eye staring. Milky white film. The eye, everywhere, everywhere, in everything. Of course, I had to get rid of the eye. So I waited. Watched. Waited. I was never so kind to the old man. I looked after him each minute, each second, and I waited. But night after night, in the hour of the slowest clock, I opened the old man's door. The eye was always closed. For 7 days I waited. You think me mad? What madman would wait, could wait so patiently, so long, in the old house, with the old man and the eye that... Then on the eighth night, I knew. Tonight. Still, I waited, while time slowed, stopped, ebbed out. A watch's hand moved more quickly than mine. Then... What? No! For an hour, I did not move a muscle. I could feel the earth turn. The eye. Hear the spider spinning. In the house, the grinding crumble of decay. Then, something else. Dull and muffled, yet... Of course! It was the beating of the old man's heart. He knew. So strong for such an old man. Louder then. And still louder. For all the world to hear and know. I had to stop it. Then it was over. The heart was still. The eye was dead. I was free. But there was still work to be done. I replaced the planks so cleverly. No eye, not even his, could have found anything wrong. Huh? So soon.
The neighbors reported a scream. We're obliged to investigate.
A scream? My own, gentlemen. A childish dream. But come in, please. You'll want to look through the house.
That is our duty. Where's the old man?
Gone to the city.
You're up very early this morning.
The dream I spoke of, it awakened me.
When did he leave?
The old man? Yesterday.
How long will he be away?
2 weeks. Perhaps longer.
Nothing out of place here.
There is his bed. Here his cupboard. All in order.
Quite in order.
All quite in order.
Yes, nothing amiss. You understand that when a complaint is made, we have no choice...
Stay, please. Such a wretched hour. I was making tea. A hot drink will break the chill. Surely it would surprise good people how much evil the night conceals from their eyes. But not yours, to be sure. What did you say, sir? Yes, yes, of course, the hot water. It will do no harm to the bare boards. I'm a little less tidy with the old man away. Then I heard it. It might have been a hand, a clock. But no. Louder. And still louder. They must hear it. Yet they sit and talk and talk. They must. Of course they do. They know. They do. They're torturing me. Watching me. Letting it beat so that I...
Stop it! Stop it, you devils! Yes, yes, I did it. It's there, under the floor. Oh, stop it! It is the beating of his hideous heart!
True, I'm nervous. Very, very dreadfully nervous. But why will you say that I'm mad?
Now, what did I tell you? Is that not, like, completely insane? This was actually an NBC premiere in 1957, and it follows the narrator, who goes unnamed the whole time. The story, originally published by a Boston magazine in 1843, kind of like The Raven, this story picked up and just took off, but it did take some time first. There was a small interval there before people started to really see it, where Poe was just having a hard time getting anything done, and he was being paid but very small amounts for his work in these magazines. This one and The Fall of the House of the Usher, both together, are, in my opinion, his greatest stories that he's ever written. So, anyway, speaking of, here's how we're going to doctor these up. First thing we're going to do, we got this cheese basically melted on here. So we're going to take the meat, and we're going to take some green food coloring, and just put it in real thick, and brush it across. Like that. We're going to do the same thing to this burger. I find it easier to just do three lines and brush. And what's cool is with this, you got the lines ground right in for you, as they tried to make it look like it was charbroiled, when everybody knows damn well that this came off some fucking assembly line. So now what we're going to do is we're going to take these, first we're going to add a little bit of minced onion, then we're going to take just a little bit of lemon pepper, a little bit, you don't want a lot. It's just enough for taste. Now this, we're going to take, this is my blend, even though it's in a taco thing. I just never washed it. So when I finished the taco seasoning, I decided to make my own. Right across the top. Now what we're going to do is we're going to put that right in here, and that one right in here, in the center, and we're going to air fry that for about 5-10 minutes. So I guess, well shit, you know what, rather than sit here and ramble at you and fill your head full of a bunch of nonsense, and speaking of fucking, have you guys heard this new one? I'm a fucking, totally fucking oblivious to this. I don't fucking get it. They want a ban in New York City. They want to ban coal fires, like, you know, ovens, right? Coal burning ovens. That is going to single-handedly destroy the fucking pizza fucking industry in New York. Because if you go to New York, that's one place you're going to get that kind of pizza. The only fucking thing New York has to offer, and they're going to take it away. Why? Because AOC burned her fucking mouth on a slice, or some other dumbass New York politician. Right the fuck there. You're taking away people's gas stoves because you know gas cooks better than fucking electric. So only the rich people are going to have good food. That, and you're going to drive up the electric bill. Not to mention in an economy that Joe Biden has fucked so far to the hilt that electric is literally starting to cost people their lives because they're dying because they can't afford air conditioning in the summer or heat in the winter. But yeah, sure, why not? It's okay. Hey, let's just starve the Ninja Turtles. You know what? Let's watch this cartoon. And when we come back, I'll show you our hamburger. Fuck New York politicians.
A letter I had received from Roderick Usher, one of my boyhood companions. The message spoke of acute bodily illness, of a mental disorder with which he was oppressed, and of an earnest desire to see me as his best and indeed only personal friend, attempting by the cheerfulness of my society some alleviation of his malady. It was the manner in which all this and much more was said. It was the apparent heart that went with his request, which allowed me no room for hesitation. As the shades of the evening drew on, I arrived at the melancholy house of Usher. I looked upon the scene before me with an utter depression of soul, which I can compare to no earthly sensation more properly than to the after dream of the reveler upon opium, the bitter lapse into everyday life, the hideous dropping off of the veil. After exchanging greetings, my friend was quick to relay to me the nature of his illness. He suffered much from a morbid acuteness of the senses. The most insipid food was alone endurable. He could wear only garments of a certain texture. The odors of all flowers were oppressive to him. His eyes were tortured by even a faint light, and there were but peculiar sounds, and these from stringed instruments, which did not inspire him with horror. Usher's condition was rendered all the worse by the severe and long-continued illness, indeed the evidently approaching death of his tenderly beloved sister, the Lady Madeline, his sole companion for long years, his last and only relative on earth. Her decease would leave him, the hopeless and the frail, the last of the ancient race of Ushers. For several days ensuing, the Lady Madeline was unmentioned by either Roderick Usher or myself, and during this period I was busied in earnest endeavors to alleviate the melancholy of my friend. We painted and read together, or I listened, as if in a dream, to the wild improvisations of his guitar. Thank you. It is now the night of the 7th or 8th day after the death of the Lady Madeline. There has been a curious change in the manner of my friend. There are times, indeed, where his unceasingly agitated mind seems to be laboring with some oppressive secret.
And you have not seen it. But stay. You shall. You must not. You shall not behold this. I fear we will not sleep, so I will read to you, and so we will pass away this terrible night. Ethelred lifted his mace outright, and cracked, and ripped, and tore the door asunder, that the noise of the dry and hollow-sounding wood alarmed and reverberated throughout the forest. But now, champion Ethelred, upon entering within the door, was sore enraged and amazed to perceive a dragon of a scaly and prodigious demeanor. And Ethelred uplifted his mace and struck it upon the head of the dragon, which fell before him with a shriek so horrid and harsh that Ethelred had feigned to close his ears with his hands. And now the champion, bethinking himself of the brazen shield, approached valorously over the silver pavement of the castle to where the shield was upon the wall, which in sooth tarried not for his full coming, but fell down at his feet upon the silver floor with a mighty great and terrible ringing sound.
Not hear it? Yes, I hear it and have heard it. Oh, pity me, miserable wretch that I am. I dared not speak. I heard her many days now, and tonight, Ethelred, the dragon, say rather the rending of her coffin, the grating of the iron hinges of the vault. Have I not heard her footsteps on the stair? Do I not distinguish the heavy and horrible beating of her heart? Ah, madness! Madness! We have put her living in the tomb.
As I saw the mighty walls rushing asunder, there was a long, tumultuous shouting sound like the voice of a thousand waters, and the deep, dark tarn at my feet closed sullenly and silently over the fragments of the House of Usher.
Of the Usher. That story was written back in, well, it was published originally in a gentleman's magazine in 1839. Well, later the next year, it was actually included in a book of short stories and poetry, all written by Edgar Allan Poe. As you can tell, Edgar Allan Poe is definitely my favorite author. I may not read much these days, but when I do get the chance to read, this is my favorite book. In fact, the reason I had to bring this to you guys tonight, we really didn't have a show lined up. We did Maniac for this week, but we have to push it off just a little bit. I got myself in trouble with a music video I made, and I guess trash dancing on the tombstone constitutes gratuitous nudity. So, thanks to that, I wasn't able to get next week's episode out. So I hope that this one's okay and you guys are cool with it. But I had to share with you guys something. And speaking of sharing, Pam, here's your dinner. Here's mine. We've got the moldy burgers with the bloody cheese. Moldy burger and bloody cheese. They're pretty patties. As for me, ladies and gentlemen, boys and ghouls, zomboys and the ghouls from ghoul school, from me and Binks to all of you out there, I hope you guys have a great night, and we'll see you right here at our regularly scheduled time next week, right here on the Angry 80s Guy YouTube channel. Say goodbye, Binks.
Wake up, kids! It's 10:30. The youth ain't nothing really changing but the date. You a grand slammer, but you know Babe Ruth. You gotta learn how to relate. I've been swinging from the pearly gate. I got all the answers, Lord.